The Air Force dropped thousands of leaflets over northern Gaza, warning residents there to evacuate ahead of an expected military offensive. Shelling and airstrikes continued last night for the first time in this round with Hamas. The Israelis put some boots on the ground. Yesterday, the UN Security Council weighed in, expressing concern for the welfare of citizens on both sides and calling for an immediate ceasefire. Fox News correspondent David Lee Miller is on the Israel-Gaza border with the latest. Good morning, David.
Good morning, Britt. For the first time since this current conflict got underway, the Israeli military says its forces crossed the border into Gaza. Early this morning, under cover of darkness, a commando unit attacked long-range rocket launchers in Gaza City. During a firefight, four Israeli soldiers were wounded, and this all happened only hours after militants fired a barrage of rockets into central Israel.
Residents of Tel Aviv and the surrounding area much of Saturday night were racing to bomb shelters. Hamas issued a vague threat about an impending attack, and at 9:07, a barrage of rockets rained down on central Israel. Rockets threatening lives and property were intercepted by Israel's Iron Dome missile defense system. There were no injuries. Israel overnight continued airstrikes in Gaza. At least 21 people were killed during a strike at the home of the Hamas police chief. Many were reportedly leaving a nearby mosque. Israel is targeting militants' homes as part of its offensive against Hamas. In total, 120 homes have been bombed. So far, more than 150 people have been killed in Gaza, many of them civilians, including children. Israel accuses Hamas of using its own people as human shields. And Britt, as you mentioned, Israel in the past day has been dropping leaflets over northern Gaza, telling residents there to evacuate in anticipation of what they describe as a brief military operation. During the past few hours, we have seen a number of airstrikes in that area, but nowhere near the number that some had expected. This is a part of Gaza that is home to some 100,000 Palestinians. And so far today, there have been at least 60 rocket attacks, rockets fired by militants, into Israel. Britt?
David Lee Miller, thank you very much. Now let's bring in Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, who joins us from Jerusalem. Mr. Prime Minister, thank you. Nice to have you with us. Can you tell us how much of your...
Thank you. I wish it could be under other circumstances.
Understood. Can you tell us how much of your mission you have accomplished so far? What the strikes that you have mounted have accomplished so far, in your judgment?
Well, first let me say what the mission is. Our mission is to restore a sustainable quiet, sustainable security to our people by seriously degrading Hamas and other terrorist groups' capabilities in Gaza. I think we're proceeding there. We'll continue until that goal is achieved.
How much of it is achieved, sir, in your judgment so far?
Well, I'll leave that to the discussions of our inner cabinet and our general staff, but I think the important thing to understand is that we can't enable our population to be under continuous rocket fire. I mean, I just want your viewers to imagine the United States being bombarded, not in one city or two cities, but in every city between New York and Colorado. Maybe 20% of the United States would be exempt from this, 80% of your citizens would have to be in bomb shelters or ready to go into bomb shelters within a minute to a minute and a half max. You can't, no country can accept that, we can't accept that, and we'll take the necessary action to stop it.
There seems to be very little disagreement about that here in this country, Mr. Prime Minister, but obviously there's concern that a conflict like this can have unintended consequences. And people, I think, are wondering whether you are nearer the beginning of this offensive or nearer the end of it. Can you give us an assessment of that?
Well, whether we're at the beginning of the end or the end of the beginning, I'm not going to tell you that right now, because we face a very, very brutal terrorist enemy. I mean, you know, here's the difference between us. We're using missile defense to protect our civilians, and they're using their civilians to protect their missiles. That's basically the difference. They're embedding these rockets that they're firing wholesale into our cities, terrorist rocketing, trying to kill as many as they can. They're not succeeding because of two reasons. One is because we've developed this incredible missile defense system, which I think is a historic development in the history of defensive warfare, with U.S. help. And I want to thank the American people, President Obama, the U.S. Congress for helping us fund this this amazing development. But the other reason we're succeeding, you have to understand, some of the rockets do pierce through this shield. And the reason we're succeeding is also because we're targeting the rocketeers. The rocketeers are firing from homes. These homes are actually command posts of the Hamas and Islamic Jihad army. So we're that's where they have their secure communications, weapon caches, rockets, hidden map rooms, and so on. These are their command posts. Obviously, we're not going to give them immunity, and so we have to attack them, and we're trying to minimize as we can civilian casualties. But with this kind of enemy, we'll take whatever necessary means that we need to take. I tell you, Brit, we try surgical action. We're not indiscriminate. It's very tough. There are always going to be civilian casualties, which we regret. But we have to defend our people, and that's what we'll do.
How likely is it that you will need to mount a ground invasion to accomplish the mission you've described?
We'll take the means necessary. You know, if this can be achieved through diplomatic or military means, whatever military means, we'll do what is necessary, what any country would do, what the United States would do, what Britain would do, what France would do, many, many other countries understand this. I've spoken to President Obama and a good number of world leaders, and I think they all understand Israel's inherent right of self-defense, the fact that such attacks are unconscionable, the fact that they're rocketing our cities is something that no country should agree with. And I'm not going to get into the specifics of our operational response. Okay. I assure you that we have an operational response.
Understood. Let me turn to the subject of Iran, which I know is an enormous concern to you, sir. Iran's foreign minister was saying today on another broadcast, quote, "We don't see," said Mohammad Javad Zarif, "any benefit in Iran developing a nuclear weapon." And he went on to say that it's simply not happening, and so on. I think I know what your reaction to that would be, but let's hear it from you.
It's a joke. Of course they're developing nuclear weapons. They've invested not billions of, you know, you can start counting it in maybe in hundreds of billions of dollars. For what? For creating medical isotopes for Iranian patients circling the earth? What are they developing ICBMs for, if not for nuclear warheads? What are they developing these, building these enormous underground nuclear facilities, if not for nuclear weapons? If they wanted to have just civilian nuclear energy, they could have it without centrifuges for enrichment, without plutonium and the heavy water that is. These are only used for nuclear weapons, so this is a sham. I mean, I don't think anybody could take this seriously. I think we have to remember this is the same Iran that is arming, financing, training Hamas and Islamic Jihad. This is the preeminent terrorist empire of our time. Not even a terrorist state, it's a terrorist empire. It's got these terror provinces. You don't want this Iran to have neither nuclear weapons or the capability to make nuclear weapons, to enrich uranium for a nuclear bomb in short order, in a few weeks or a few months. They could do that unless that's changed. I think it's possible to stop them, Britt. I think the important thing is to replicate the Syrian deal, where the capability to make the weapons was actually dismantled and removed from the soil of Syria. The same should happen with
Iran. We're about, 8 days now from the deadline for the U.S. and its partners to reach a deal with Iran to try to dismantle its nuclear weapons program. The situation looks pretty bleak as of now. Your assessment of that, and whether any you can see the outlines of any deal that would be acceptable to you?
Well, look, Brett, I think that a bad deal is actually worse than no deal. And I can tell you what a bad deal would be, and I'll tell you what a good deal would be. A bad deal would be that Iran gets to keep its enriched nuclear material and the capacity to enrich further to make a bomb, and put inspectors there, leave them with the capability and put inspectors there, trust them not to break out. I think that's a terrible deal. A good deal is what was achieved under President Obama, the United States cooperating with Russia in the case of Syria. They didn't tell Assad there, okay, you can keep your chemicals and the means to convert these chemicals into chemical weapons, and we'll inspect them. That's what the Iranians are suggesting.
That's not what the
deal in Syria was. The deal was you actually dismantle these materials and these capabilities and you ship them out of Syria.
Got it.
That's a good deal.
How likely?
That deal would be good.
If you can get it, do it.
If you can't get it, don't make a bad deal.
How likely is it, given what you know of the negotiations, that the kind of bad deal you describe may be what emerges here?
I certainly hope that doesn't happen, because I think it would be a catastrophic development. Because, you know, the Middle East is in turmoil. Everything is topsy-turvy. The worst militants, Shiites and Sunni radicals, are vying with each other who'll be the king of this Islamist hill. And from there, they'll go on and attack the United States, whom they see as the great Satan. We're, in this case, only your appendage in their eyes. And in a certain sense, they're right. We're part of that same hated civilization of freedom that they despise so much. But if any one of these sides, and in this case, the militant Shiites led by Iran, get their hands on nuclear weapons, then all bets are off. I think the Middle East would, many nations would rush to have their own nuclear weapons here. I think these people who support terrorists would now have a nuclear weapon shield. It would be a disaster for the United States and for everyone else.
Mr. Prime Minister, thank you very much, sir.
I hope it doesn't happen. I'm working so it doesn't happen.
Understood. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Britt. Thank you.